Michael Hillemann with us from Uppsala University, and he will be presenting a new theory, physical mechanism of deflagration to deflagration transition. Please.
So, I should talk about part of this big project. And here I wrote names of the person who contributed in this talk, in this presentation. So this project joins several institutions. Partly it is Department of Physics of Southern University. It is Kabelsun Institute of Nuclear Physics. It is Institute of High Temperature Physics. You can see that heavily it is based on this who originated from Russia, even real Russian or Russian Jewish people and so on. Experimental part of this work has been done in Germany. It is an international project. And in Kurchatov Institute, it is a large-scale experiment. So what I shall talk about today, it is origin and physical mechanism of deflagration to deflagration transition. And here, very important is to use detailed chemistry. Because of using one-step chemical model leads to serious mistakes, and I would say to totally incorrect conclusions about mechanism of transition. And this is very important for understanding of interaction of the turbulence with flame. It is quite simple to understand because of if you consider the flame brush and interaction of the flame brush with the turbulent flow, then you, if you use one step chemical kinetics, then on the front edge of the flame brush you have already induction time, which is totally incorrect, too fast. So, but today I shall talk about this one. So, what is important here, it is origin and physical mechanism responsible for deflagration to deflagration transition. And this is done for several mixtures, reactive mixtures, like hydrogen oxygen, ethylene oxygen, it is quite fast, hydrogen air, ethylene air, acetylene, and so on. What is important here is to use and to choose correct, I would say, detailed chemistry, because of, you know, it is impossible to use a total chemical mechanism. For example, for hydrogen air, total number of reactions is something 137. So it should be reduced to some reasonable amount. What's the problem here is that when we are talking about transition from deflagration to detonation, this chemical mechanism should be reliable for wide range of pressures, say from torus up to 10th atmosphere. It's very, very wide. So, what we do? So we use detailed mechanism, and here it is written just our tools, how it has been done, and what kind of machine. I shall go to the history of the program. The first and more or less reasonable, at least it looked quite natural mechanism of transition was proposed by Zeldovich. And the idea was gradient mechanism. It was done, it was proposed by Zeldovich in 1977. Idea was like this, that If there is a gradient of induction time or temperature, then reactions start at higher temperatures, then at lower temperature, like this. And this means that reaction will propagate in a spontaneous way, which is time derivative of induction time dx, this is x minus 1. And velocity of spontaneous way can be any depending on the gradient of the temperature. If there is no gradient of the temperature, then velocity is infinite because it is adiabatic explosion. If gradient is infinite, then velocity equal to zero and reaction propagates due to thermal conduction as deflagration in slow combustion engine. In intermediate case, it can be different velocity. If velocity is close to the local speed of sound, then there is a transition to detonation. It was demonstrated only using one-dimensional model. And it was never suggested by Zeldovich himself as mechanism for transition to detonation. But seem, because of model seems very natural, many researchers accepted this idea as a mechanism of transition. The principal question was, where is and how gradient of temperature or gradient of reactivity can be formed during transition. And there was, during many years, from 1977 up to today, many numerical simulations where different researchers try to find out origin of gradient mechanism, how it is, how it works, and so on.
IMV means what?
What?
IMV, you said. Yes. How is that? IMV, what is this?
Induction.
This is induction time.
Induction.
What does it mean precisely? It's time of chemical reaction, typical time of chemical reaction.
Induction time.
Okay.
Idea of induction time heavily based on one-step reaction. And this, if you write down equation for chemical reaction, then characteristic time of the reaction, that is induction time.
Is it equivalent to ignition delay time? Talk about ignition delay time.
Ignition delay.
Yeah, it is the same as ignition delay and ignition time. Different name for this induction time. I usually use, following Zeldovich, I use name of induction time. It is, but some people call it ignition delay or ignition time or something like this.
I think it's possible calculating for enough complicated.
Right. So, my understanding of the detonation, the deflagration, transition, physics is important. It is, first of all, it is industrial application like accident explosion and so on. Second, it is hydrogen safety, which is important for nuclear power stations. And then finally, it is interesting problem in astrophysics. It is explosion of thermonuclear supernova. What we did, modeling, two-dimensional modeling of compressible reactive Navier-Stokes equations with all transport, including diffusion, thermal conduction, viscosity for these species. This is hydrogen and oxygen and radicals. This transport coefficients were calculated from the first principle for kinetic theory. The problem is stated like this. There is a tube, closed end of the tube here, here in this radiated flame, which propagates in this direction to the open end.
This is 2D problem. Yeah?
2D problem. Right now I am talking about 2D problem. We did such calculations for 3D problem, but the results are the same. So it is more interesting to consider.
So x is in a long YouTube, say.
Sorry?
X is a long YouTube.
Yeah.
And that in this
direction. No. There is a tube filled with hydrogen plus oxygen. Flame integrated near the closed end of the tube and propagates from the left to the right to the open end of the tube.
I speak of in this picture, where is X and Z? In this tube.
Yeah.
No?
Okay.
So, I have a question. You say that the...
So,
there's a question maybe first. So you say that it doesn't make any difference if you go from 2D to 3D.
You know, my hearing ability is really low.
So you say that there is no difference going from two dimension to three dimension.
There's no principal difference.
So the turbulence in the flame region is not important. Because I would expect them to be
what
different.
What I am talking about right now, it is, you will see that turbulence is not involved in the process. There is a turbulence in the boundary layer, but there is no turbulence in the bulk of the motion.
Is it possible?
It's possible, yeah.
Because of the fast time? Fast processes.
Because of the very fast flame. For slower flame, turbulence will be more important and more, maybe even key for solution of the problem.
Very
but
fast
now turbulence is only in the boundary layer. So this is how calculated transport coefficients, so viscosity, thermal conduction, diffusion coefficient, and this equation for concentration of the spaces. This is reactions that involved in the process. It's 9 reactions with pre-exponential coefficient and oscillation energy here. Now this is a result of the modeling. You can see what is shown here, it is the density gradient. Here it is the flame, which propagates in this direction from the closed end. Usually it is shown only part of the calculation of the domain. Here it is the shock produced by the flame, because the flame accelerates in this direction and produces compression waves that stiffens to the shock. What is important here, it is that you can see at the beginning flame producing shock waves here, and starting from some time, there is no shock far ahead. All the shocks produced and stiffen, I would say in such way, compression by steepens on in the shock directly on the flame surface here. You may ask me about symmetrical and asymmetrical picture here. We especially impose small perturbation on the flame to make simulation more reasonable compared to the experiment. Without numerical noises are very small, and if there is no initial perturbations, then flame acquires such a tulip flame, tulip shape, that there is no difference. So from this moment, from 0.4 milliseconds, shocks are on the front of the flame, and you can see here the last instant before the transition. After this instant, there is a transition to detonation, and here you can see detonation wave and detonation wave propagation of the wave.
If we compare it two times.
What?
If we compare it two times.
Yeah.
One is sound times, propagation of sound waves, and another is the propagation of flame. These times are comparable or not?
Oh, no. No, it's not comparable time because of flames start propagating. Okay. Velocity of the flame from the beginning. Velocity of the plane laminar flame is 8.9 meters per second. Sound velocity is 550 meters per second.
But this once, once you have detonation, then it becomes comparable, right?
Yes, sure. When we are coming to detonation, then here you can see dynamics of the flame. And this is the key point, in fact. This shown for different widths of the channel. Here is 5 millimeters, 3, 1, and 1.5 millimeter. In fact, previous calculation figures were for wider channels, but it is not possible to put everything here. The most important thing here is that if you look on the dynamics of the flame, it is not seen here, I will show you. Velocity of the flame grows exponentially fast in time, very short time, up to something here, 0.4 milliseconds. Then it slows down for a long time, and then abrupt transition to detonation. Velocity of detonation we can see from here. There is from the beginning overdriven detonation, and then it relaxes to the challenging detonation, except of the thin channel. In the thin channel, velocity starts to grow exponentially fast from the very beginning, without this stage. Then there is a very slight overdriven detonation, and then it propagates with velocity below the challenging detonation. And this what we want to explain theoretically, and this what we want to compare with experiments.
Sorry, what was this, when you reached this 2800 value, what was that called again?
In the flame speed, yeah?
The
CJ.
It's not the flame speed already. The flame speed grows like this.
Then
and then abruptly ahead of the around 3000, that is detonation.
Why is it not actually called detonation much earlier? I mean, what exactly makes...
You mean here much earlier?
Yeah,
here it is early because of channel is thinner. As wider channel, as later transition to detonation. As larger roughness of the wall, as early transition to detonation. There are several things. What's the difference between thin channel and wide channel? In the wide channel, the flow is almost uniform in the bulk here, with a very thin boundary layer like here. Flow ahead of the flame, here is a flame which propagates from the left to the right, which produces flow ahead of the flame. There is no positive flow with parabolic velocity profile in wide channel. And parabolic velocity profile of the flow, positive flow, will appear only in a channel which is thinner than 1 millimeter. And this is explained the difference in the flame dynamics which you can see here, this one. Here it is zoomed dynamics of the flame. You can see what is going on with the for a wide channel. Exponential growth here for a short time, which then going like this slowly. And here is a wider channel, and here, and then when we are coming to the channel thinner than 1 millimeter, then all the way there is exponential growth of the velocity, and then transition to exponential.
What does it mean, dashed lines in this?
What?
Dashed lines.
This one?
No, dashed, yes, it's some curves and dashed lines. Eh?
What?
There's a solid lines
and dashed.
Dashed.
Dashed line, it is exponential approximation. By dashed line everywhere, we checked that growth is exponential.
In some range.
Yes.
Can I ask a question?
So what the difference is? The difference is that this is exponential growth, and this is growth like what?
Sorry, I have a question. What happened with the local velocity when you have an exponential growth time? Your wave is 200 meters per second. Is the flow following the wave?
Wait a moment, I shall talk about physics of this.
Okay.
First, I want just to show you result of simulation, and then I will explain all the physics, what is going on. What's the difference here between this stage and this stage? Difference is that flame propagates with velocity which depends exponentially in time from here, and then velocity change in some function a plus t n, where n is less than 1, and this is important. So what we observed in simulations that there are three stages of flame dynamics. First is exponential acceleration of the flame. Then acceleration of the flame decreases, and flame generates what is the most important consequence of this stage is that in this stage flame produces compression waves which steep into shocks at the flame front exactly. And this is what I shall talk about more in more details. And the last during this stage, when it's happened already, pressure pulse steepens, will grow exponentially, and finally steepens in a strong shock wave, which is actual transition to deformation. This is the result of simulation. At the last instant, just 1 microsecond before transition to deformation start, here still there is a flame already formed a large peak of the pressure. And this shown for different, this is 1 atmosphere and this is 1.5 atmosphere. So it is almost the same. So this is pressure from peak, which is formed directly on the flame front. And this is density. This is the flame front itself. Temperature ahead of the flame is below 500 or 550 degrees Kelvin, which means that reaction is totally frozen in front of the flame. And this means that there is no any possibility for gradient mechanism. So the Liebovitz mechanism doesn't work in this case. What is going on the next stage? Here shown flame fronts, it is this obtained for 5 millimeter width of the channel. Dashed line is temperature, so you can see flame front here. And solid line, it is a pressure profile. And you can see that it will grow exponentially fast, forming a very high amplitude pressure peak, very narrow, exactly on the flame on the front of the flame. Here it is calculated pressure, and this is just approximation of the exponential drawings for the pressure. Okay. Just to check. The fact that pressure should grow exponentially fast is quite obvious, but I was not able to obtain number here. So, analytically, I don't know how to do this. So, what is going after this? It is already transition to detonation. After previous stage, you can see how transition happened. This is flame, and then after exponential growth, it is overdriven detonation, and then detonation by itself.
The detonation wave, is that always plane parallel?
Almost. Here it is better seen what is the meaning of detonation, because of here it is shown several radicals together with temperature. So this is temperature, and if you compare regime of deflagration, you can see that reaction already started at the front edge of temperature profile. In detonation regime, reactions start after the leading shock rise temperature, and only after behind of the leading shock started any reactions and appear any results. So this is a result of simulation, and then I answer your question on physics of this process. When flames start, this is schematically shows the problem, cool stand of the channel. Flames start from here. Velocity equal to zero is the closed end. Flame, relative in laboratory coordinate system, propagates with velocity OLF, which is ratio of the unborn to born matter, density of the theta here, it is density of unborn to density of the born matter. And here, from the very beginning, produced flow with velocity theta minus 1 OF. OF, it is the normal velocity of planar flame. So, why this flow is produced? Because of expanding matter here, this high temperature, push gas here. So flame, relative to the unborn gas, flame propagates with normal velocity OF. Here is velocity with the flow with this velocity, and flame propagates like this. There is a shock wave here, ahead of the flame, far ahead of the flame. And then let's analyze what is going on inside of the channel. Because of there is velocity, flow with velocity here, there is a boundary layer near the both walls. And thickness of the boundary layer defined like difference between coordinates of the shock and flame divided by Reynolds number, which is about this several widths of the channel divided by Reynolds number, but Reynolds number is much larger than unity, and because of this it is much thinner than the channel itself. Reynolds number, it is convenient to rewrite in such a way that Reynolds number, I'm thinking quite. You and use a relation between normal velocity of flame, thickness of the flame, which is of order of kinematic responsivity. And then for Reynolds number, I have such a
expression. This is ratio of the densities and ratio of the width of the channel to the width of the flow. What is going then? Because of flow ahead of the flame has velocity profile has such a shape. Flame will acquire similar shape because of velocity of the in every point velocity of the flame front consists of the normal velocity of the flame plus velocity of the flow which is drifted flame ahead. And because of this, flame acquires the same shape as shape of the velocity profile ahead. So flame front will be stretched along the boundary layer.
Sorry, what is the LF? This is a sequence of LF.
Lens,
LF. What is
the,
this is
a
sequence of
this is a sequence of the flame front.
Okay.
Now we should consider two things. There is a velocity of the flame itself, local velocity of the flame front. And there is a meaning of the burning rate, or I should call it velocity of the combustion wave itself. Velocity of the combustion wave can be defined like this. It is the same as the burning rate. It is total flux of the fuel which is going through the surface, through the total surface of the flame, and normalized on the cross-section of the tube. In this way, velocity of the combustion wave or burning rate will be proportional to the surface of the flame front, total surface of the flame front. With increase of the total of the surface of the flame, will increase velocity of the combustion wave. Because of boundary layer is very thin and flame front is stretched along to the boundary layer, velocity of combustion wave will increase with accuracy of the ratio of boundary layer, thickness of the boundary layer to the thickness of the tube. It will grow linearly in time. Surface will grow linearly in time. The surface will grow velocity and vice versa, which means that velocity of the flame of the combustion wave will should grow exponentially fast. Here, what is written here, it is estimate for time when parabolic velocity, parabolic profile of the velocity will be established ahead of the flame. This problem is quite simple. It is the same as time for establishing of positive flow when flow is entering enter into the tube. This time is much larger than the time of the whole process, which means that it depends, of course, on the Reynolds number, on the ratio of the width of the channel to the width of the flame. So what we have here now, it is expression for growth of the combustion wave velocity, which is growing exponentially fast. Solution is quite obvious. It can be written just from dimensional consideration, nothing more. Alpha is a numerical factor, which is of order of unity, and we will check with numerical simulations that it is correct, that it is exactly equal to 1, almost equal to 1. Here it is conversion of this analytical solution with numerical simulation. What is done, what is shown here, depending on the how we initiated flame, it can be, and what is measured in an experiment. When experiment is done, velocity can be measured. Is, for example, flame may acquire such shape. It is a leaf shape, like typical for flame propagation continues. Then an experiment measured because of experimentally measured flame velocity in this point. Then it will be like this green line. If there is a perturbation from the beginning and flame front became like this, then it is this one. Then there is a, this dashed line are integral velocity, so velocity of combustion, but not local velocity of the flame. And finally, this is for synth channels. But in any case, we can see that alpha is of order of unity.
UF versus UF, ULF, what is the difference again? UF is the coefficient and ULF the constant.
UF, it is a normal velocity of plane of flame. ULF, it is combustion wave velocity. It is velocity what is measured in laboratory coordinate system. So velocity relative to the channel walls.
And intuitively, why is it actually that the flame begins to accelerate more slowly for a wider channel?
Wait a moment. I shall talk about. It is not exactly like more slowly. It is different dynamics of the flame. Acceleration of the flame almost the same, not the same of course, but quite similar for channel width larger than some critical value. Critical value, it is a value of the width of the channel when positive or parabolic velocity profile is formed almost immediately from the very beginning ahead of the plane. Until there is no positive velocity profile, there is dynamics of the flame and flame velocity which looks like this. This and then transition to the dimension. When I am talking about critical width of the channel, this means that dynamics of the flame axis. So, what is going on then? Flame propagating with acceleration together with the Born gas behind of the flame acts like a piston, accelerating piston, producing compression waves, which steepens and shocks ahead, and where shocks will appear can be obtained by solving well-known problem for Riemann solution, where Riemann solution ahead of the for compression wave ahead of the flame will become multi-wavelet solution. So these are conditions that these two derivative cancel to zero. It is quite standard problem and it's very simple. For exponential acceleration of the flame, shock wave is formed in the intermediate point of compression wave with Mach number, which can be estimated like this. And coordinates for shock is this one, which shows that solution for difference between coordinate of flame and thickness of the boundary layer is self-consistent. What will go then? When flame continue propagates and stretch this part of the flame front, this part, I have some diagram here which this is how change shape of the flame. So it was like this, and then stretched more along the, to the boundary layer. And when it stretched more, this part will become closer to the wall of the channel. And when it becomes closer to the wall of the channel, this interesting thing, independently on either it is adiabatic condition for the walls, or there is a strong heat losses to the walls. About the same estimate for time when this part of the flame front will distinguish either due to quenching or due to acceleration of this part of the flame because of increase of the temperature between the flame and the adiabatic wall here in the center. When temperature increases here, this part will run much faster. And all of this process will decrease surface of the flame. Decreases surface of the flame means that so this is this time. This time is short, and with the accuracy of the ratio of the thickness of the flame front to the tube width, acceleration during this time at the initial stage, at the first stage, was constant. Decrease of the surface of the flame means decrease of the acceleration, and this means that on the next stage I can approximate velocity of combustion wave by any function of this type, just below constant acceleration. Difference between the first stage and the second stage is the following, that for such dependence of the velocity of the piston, Riemann solution is multivalued for any time and always multivalued, which means that compression wave steepens into the shock directly on the surface of the piston. And this is the second stage of flame acceleration, this slower stage, when ahead of the piston there is a shock which compressed matter increases density, and now fuel with a higher density start to enter and consume by the flame. This results in increase in the pressure, and this increase in the pressure is quite obvious that it should be exponential in time increase, because of increase in the pressure means formation of the means that appeared a feedback coupled between acceleration, additional acceleration of the flame, and rise of the pressure pulse. Half width of the pressure pulse I can estimate as approximately width of the flame itself, the flame front. Because what is the meaning of this process? Meaning of this process is that this is the temperature, final temperature and initial temperature. When higher pressure, higher density appeared here and entered the flame front, it's heated, this fuel heated, and of course appeared the pulse of the pressure on the width of the flame itself. And then, when it will rise, it, it will, it is rising up to the ratio of 10 or 12 atmosphere, and finally steepen into the it steepened into the strong shock. I lost one diagram. It steepened into the strong shock, and quite obvious time for steepening into shock and transition to detonation. This time should be of the order of time which need for characteristic to clash each other. One characteristic which going from the peak of the pressure, and another characteristic is going from the pedestal of the pressure. Time for intersection of such characteristics should be of the order of width of the flame divided by sound velocity. And this is about 1 microsecond. what was found in numerical. And now, what's the difference depending on the width of the channel? When width of the channel is lower than some critical value, as I said, it is such value of the width when Reynolds number is small, so that quasi flow established ahead of the flame almost immediately after ignition of the flame. Then, in this case, flame velocity should grow exponentially from the very beginning up to the transition to detonation. Here is experiment by Wu, Wang, and Yang, and Yadav. With ethylene oxygen in capillary tube, 3 millimeter, and you can see first it is in such a diagram it is not seen exponential growth. It looks like linear. Linear growth of velocity, then it slows down and transition to detonation. Then with increase of the diameter of the tube for 0.5 millimeter exponential growth, and then such a galloping detonation. This is what is seen in simulation, such a galloping detonation, and this is what is seen in this simulation, that velocity of the detonation is smaller than Chep and Jugier. And this is experiment in wide and long channels. In fact, it is experiment in large shock tubes for hydrogen oxygen. So experiments have been done for different roughness of the tube, of the wall, which is shown here. But anyway, dynamics of the flame is very similar for all pressure and all roughness. First linear growth, then slows down, and then transition to detonation. more accurate measurement of the initial state shows that at the beginning velocity of the combustion wave grows exponentially fast everywhere. And here, what is what I said, how measured velocity. This decrease of the velocity related to formation of the tubular flame, and this in the experiment, it is seen like decrease of the velocity only because of velocity measured as the axis of the tube. If you measure velocity integral of the velocity, so velocity of the combustion wave, it will increase. It will grow, it will continue growing like this. Here it is a shadow photograph, and it is seen what I explained about physics of the acceleration of the plane. This is the initial stage, and you can see here formation of the fold between the wall and the plane front. The fold becomes deeper and deeper and deeper, and then it will start decreasing. Flames start like front. Fold decreases already. And this is a stage of slowdown of the flame. It continues to grow. If you measure velocity, as I said, here, it seems like decreasing velocity. In fact, it will continue increasing. Exactly the same, I would say, dynamics of the flame is for ethylene oxygen, also for different roughness and in wide range of the pressure. Again, it is the same dynamics, linear increase of the velocity, then some second stage when formed such a precise zone of the high density fresh fuel attached exactly to the flame front ahead, and after this stage, a drop transition to detonation. Not in all experiments it was possible to observe where are and how exactly shock waves are formed, but here, because of special installation of the optics, it is seen that during the last stage, just before transition to detonation, shock waves are formed exactly very close to the flame front. This white strip, it is the shock waves which are formed, and when the second stage is coming to the end, after this photo, here already the detonation wave. From here to here, there is a transition to the foundation. This is a form such a compressed preheat zone ahead of the
field. How does the Reynolds number change during the entire process?
How the
Reynolds number?
How does the Reynolds number change? It depends on how you define the Reynolds number. I already seen a different definition for Reynolds number. Some people define Reynolds number like UF D nu. We define Reynolds number like this. And velocity ahead increases all the time till the transition, but Reynolds number change, let's see, in white tubes like this, for this experiment, Reynolds number change from 10 into 3 up to 10 into 4. So, which means that, and this is confirmed by experimental measurements, that flow in the bulk ahead of the flame is laminar, but boundary layer may be turbulized. In fact, it is seen turbulization of the boundary layer, but since it is much thinner than, it's very thin, in fact, the thickness of the boundary layer here, when width of the tube was 5 centimeter, was maximum width was 4 millimeters. And it was not simple to say for sure that it is the turbulent boundary layer or it is laminar boundary layer. But it doesn't matter for the overall picture of transition, it doesn't matter if it is laminar or turbulent. And concluding, I would say that in this work, transition to deformation was simulated from the first principle, resolving all the scales from width of the flame up to the thickness of the channel. We suggested new mechanism of transition to detonation, which is formation of the large amplitude pressure pulse, which thickens, which formed during the second stage and steepened into strong shock, which is coupled with flame from the very beginning, and because of this form or driven detonation. I would say that for the first time, the theory and simulation provide us with a very good quantitative agreement with laboratory experiment, which was not done before in any work. And we obtain insight into how and where the data occurs in this simulation. By the way, compared to about the thin capillary channels, in the thin channel, compared to the wider channels, where second stage is important, here, because of thickness of the channel is of order of thickness of the flame itself, shock waves from the very beginning, in spite of the exponential acceleration of the flame, one can see that because of flame accelerates exponentially, and everything as a piston should produce shock wave far ahead. It's not far ahead because of the thin channel. And this means that in this case, for thickness of the channel less than 1 millimeter, shock waves are produced very close to the flame itself on the distance of the order, because of distances of the order of a few thickness of the channel. This is the same order as the thickness of the flame itself. And because of this, in thin channel, these shocks formed the high density preheat zone immediately from the very beginning. So, and mechanism is the same, and it was seen here by in this case pressure pulse grows exponentially from the very beginning, from here, compared to the wide channel, where in wide channel there is a stage where pressure pulse grows slowly and then will start to grow exponentially. In a thin channel, it will grow exponentially from the very beginning, immediately after ignition of the flame, like here. Well, so this is the reference of the papers where these results either published or will appear soon. And thank you. Mm-hmm.
Thank you very much.
Is that the Shibashinsky from Kuramoto? Shibashinsky? Mm-hmm. The question was, is it the same Grisha Sivashinsky which wrote the famous paper about Kuramoto Sivashinsky equation.
Yes.
The same, the same.
This is Grisha Sivashinsky from Tel
Aviv. Yeah, I know.
Yeah. We started to work together on this problem of transition to detonation several years ago. Mm-hmm. And then all the work developed as real mechanism of transition.
I would like to ask a question. Seems that your theory is built on the geometry that you have one end closed, you have one channel, one of the two, one end opens.
Yeah.
I wonder what's happening if you have both ends open. Do you develop to detonation?
This is quite a different problem because if both both ends of the channel are open, then there is no such a picture for flame acceleration.
Yeah.
Flame accelerates only if one end is closed.
Yeah.
Because of if when this end closed, when this end closed, then flame in laboratory coordinate system start propagating with velocity, normal velocity. If both M open, then flame will propagate with velocity, with normal velocity. It will be corrugated, convoluted, and so on. But it will be only normal velocity of the flame. If I close this M, then velocity of the flame in laboratory coordinate system, LF, is ratio of the density of the velocity. And this is an important factor.
Then I have a follow-up question.
Otherwise it will be, you know that.
What happened?
The question you are asking more or less related to the problem of unconfined transition to detonations.
Okay.
It is not very clear, is unconfined transition is possible or not possible. Experimentally, it was not observed in any case.
I have a question that I'm very interested in. What happens if you close both ends?
Mm. If you close both ends, well, then it will accelerate transition to detonation. And that's quite obvious, because if I close this end, why we are talking about, why experiments have been done in very long shock tubes? To model open end, because of, to avoid reflection of the pressure waves, shock waves from this end to the flame. If I close this end, then this is another problem that maybe I shall talk about next time or sometime. It is a problem of transition of interaction between flame and shock waves. In any case, this will accelerate transition to detonation. And this tells us, if I close this end, then propagating flame in this direction will rise pressure here. Rising pressure will rise velocity of the flame. Or, I would say, better to say physically, rising pressure will rise rate of all reactions ahead.
Rather consumption.
Because look, that, for example, if we are talking about, let's talk about this using one-step reaction model, because in this way it is more simple to understand general overall picture. Hydrogen, oxygen, it is approximately set order reaction. Then reaction rate as high pressure. If I close this end, rises the pressure here, there will rise rate of the reaction. Right? Rise rate of the reaction will accelerate frame in this direction. And this will make transition faster than this opening. That's it.
So it should be explosion. Something similar to explosion.
Yeah. And another problem, of course, a very interesting problem with this interaction of the flame with shock reflected from this end. This is another problem. Also problem of transition to detonation, which involves several other mechanisms like Richtmeier, Mishkov instability, and so on. But this is another story. But also, this correct description of this process requires use simulation with detailed chemistry. This one step chemical model is totally incorrect.
Okay.
At the exit, you have also transitioned from the subsonic to supersonic. At the exit of the outflow, yes, you have also a transition, between the subsonic flow and the supersonic flow. And which kind of treatment do you use?
Which kind of
treatment of boundary conditions? No? You don't understand.
What is the numerical treatment and what are the conditions on the boundary? That's essentially what you're asking, right?
Yeah. Because it's difficult to deal with some change, no? Of, no?
Not so.
Uh-huh.
I don't think so.
I don't think.
I don't see any problem here.
Yeah.
What do you mean? The boundary condition?
Yeah, the boundary condition, because at the beginning it is subsonic.
The boundary condition here is boundary condition which we use here, it is no slip.
Not more.
At the outflow. Here?
Yeah.
It is no slip false boundary condition.
Yes, I know it's not.
That's all.
It's closed,
in there are two kinds of boundary conditions which imposed and used in the problem. Is we are modeling roughness of the wall, like that. Mm-hmm. Or just smooth walls with velocity equal to zero on the wall, that's all.
On the open boundary,
it is open, and that's all. All perturbations are going away.
Well,
No. This is the open boundary means that the open end means that the in simulations end is taken far enough from the flame.
Okay. Mm-hmm. But so no boundary conditions here.
Let me ask two questions. First, but nevertheless, if I try to solve equation with open boundary conditions, what should be? dp dx equals zero?
Yeah.
Uh-huh. And second question, how complicated should be chemistry in order to find something? How complicated?
Yeah.
How many reactions in principle would you should involve in order to get something non-trivial?
It depends. It depends on what kind of mixture considered. Because for hydrogen oxygen, it was enough 9 reactions.
Mm-hmm.
It was checked using the whole kinetic for hydrogen oxygen from choosing from 27 or 32 reactions, all reactions that which may contribute and may be important for this, for all range of the pressures. If we are talking about hydrogen air mixture, then we had to take more, something about 20 reactions.
Mm-hmm.
if talking about hydrocarbons, then situation much worse because of for real hydrocarbons, real kinetics consist of, I don't remember, 1,000 reactions. But it is possible at least to be restricted something between 20 and 30 reactions, just for reasonably fast calculations. Otherwise, it will be totally unreasonable to think. Anyway, we did not check this for and verify this for some complex carbons, but for methane, it was quite good agreement with this experimental situation. At least accuracy of a few percent compared to the experiment was considered as quite good. Here, for hydrogen oxygen, accuracy was much higher. For example, critical diameter for ethylene oxygen, this experiment by Wu, from this simulation and analytical estimates was predicted 0.45 millimeter, and the experiment has shown that it is this experimental accuracy 1.5 millimeter, so it's not too bad. And time for transition and distance for transition to detonation in white tubes was predicted with accuracy of 7%, including everything. Pressure, dynamics of the flame, propagates within the tube, and so on.
Any other questions? Yes, please.
What kind of boundary condition do you use for temperature? You assume the walls were adiabatic?
The walls? Here? Here?
Yeah, for the numerical simulation. Your walls were adiabatic?
No, heat losses to
zero. Oh, yes. Yeah. Because in the experiments, you don't have
it. In fact, it depends. What we verified that for white channels, white is 5 millimeters, roughly. It doesn't matter adiabatic or heat losses taken in the time. For thin channel, of course, for channels thinner than 2 millimeter. This became important when size of detonation cells will become comparable to the width of the channel. So this for hydrogen oxygen for one atmosphere, size of the detonation cell something 2.4 millimeter. And because of this, for D equal to 2 millimeter width of the channel, heat losses to the wall becomes important. It's important in a sense to compare with experiment, to compare with galloping detonation which appear in a thin channel. It's important to compare with velocity of the detonation which will establish at the end of the process. It is here. For this channel, in fact, velocity is somewhere here. It is lower than Chapman-Jouguet velocity. Okay. And this is seen in simulations. First of all, it is seen such an oscillation, developing detonation, and then velocity is also below the Chapman-Jouguet velocity.
Did you manage to capture the cells, the detonation cells, the shape of the detonation?
Sorry?
Did you manage to capture the cells of the detonation shell?
Yeah.
Because in the simulation, I didn't see them. Maybe I missed the point. In your results, I didn't see the shape of the detonation is quite plain. It should be
shape of the detonation itself.
Yeah, which remains quite plain. Tana.
Shape of the detonation front is. It is not wrinkled. It is plain, and cell structure is behind of the. If you look on the look that
hello.
If you look on the shape of the formation, it is plain. And cell structure is behind us.
Okay.
Front. Not here. All right. There is no wrinkling here on the front itself. And this is also quite obvious because of structure of the deformation consists of the leading shock front, which is stable, and because of this it is planar. And then it is reaction zone where will appear cell structure. It is quite different compared to the flame itself because of flame propagating with stronger substrate velocity may become wrinkled and corrugated.
Yeah, but for large
channels
you should have observed the.
No, even in very wide channel, shape of the detonation front,
yeah.
Almost, I don't know, very wide channel, but in widest, I say, that I know experimentally, in experiment, the widest, the largest diameter of the shock sphere was something 10 centimeters.
Yeah.
And even at for 10 centimeters, front was was
quite
yeah.
It's very weird.
I never saw in experiment any wrinkles on the detonation.
Yeah, you have instead wrinkles. You have pressure waves traveling in the transverse way. You see, you don't have observed.
I can answer one day.
Okay.
What I know.
So there are also so numerical simulations of such cellular detonations.
Yeah.
But cells observe this kind of.
But cells are behind the front.
Behind.
Front
is
still.
It's almost the front is almost flat.
Yeah.
And you observe the trace of the pressure peak. In
if you mean that with accuracy of the cells on the front itself,
I think you're accurate.
Yeah, yeah.
I think you're accurate.
If you think this about this, then there is a cells. You can see cells from this side, of the but it is not wrinkles. Wrinkles the front itself.
And what happens if you don't have enough, that's the same question as yours. If you don't have enough reactions in the model, if you take a single step reaction, what happens? What do you observe? You don't observe the same steps.
I don't know what will happen if I have no enough reactions. I know what will happen if one use one step.
One single step.
For one step model, there is a problem like this. Usually people who are modeling transition to detonation with one step Arrhenius kinetic use Arrhenius kinetic with quite low activation energy. This means that it is done because of they need to resolve width of the plane to put let's say 10 grid points within them. Then what will happen? Induction time in this case will be very short. Unreasonably short. And it looks like ignition ahead of the flame. At temperature where in real mixture there is no ignition even for fastest reactions. For example, it looks like this. Where from appeared wrong idea about temperature gradient, the mechanism for transition? This idea appeared in such a way that this is a temperature plate, and there is some small pedestal here with low temperature. Temperature here, as we calculated in this here, for example, hydrogen-oxygen is a very fast reaction, maybe one of the fastest. Temperature here is below 550 Kelvin. Of course, there is no any reaction here. Reaction is totally frozen. But if I take one-step model, one-step Arrhenius, with low observation energy, then I obtain the induction time for this temperature will be something of order of 10 minus 5, I don't remember exactly. Real induction time for this temperature is years or 100 seconds. You know, and total time of the whole process is a few milliseconds. But if I take one step reaction, then I can say, oh, okay, this gradient may induce transition to detonation or may work like a gradient mechanism. In fact, I see the gradient mechanism may be applicable, but for very low flames, like methane, for example, or some hydrocarbons, where flame is strongly turbulized during transition. In situation like this,
would that mean low flame?
Flame brush will appear.
Would that mean low flame?
Low velocity flame.
Low velocity.
Low velocity flame, I mean that like methane oxygen or methane air, it is very low velocity. At least one order of magnitude lower velocity than hydrogen oxygen. Then there is there appear a flame brush due to turbulence here. And if there is if it will appear deep fold in the flame brush, then fresh mixture trapped inside of the fold here can be heated by heat flux from the edge of the flame here, and then appear locally such situation flame, and then gradient of the temperature. In fact, gradient of the temperature not important in this case also, but appearance of the temperature with amplitude larger than some critical amplitude may result in widening of the flame front itself like this, and this will be gradient temperature gradient and gradient of the induction time, which result in the Zeldovich mechanism for transition. It can be. I cannot guarantee we didn't finish this study
because
for such situation.
Because it's turbulent.
But because of turbulence. Because of turbulence and because of formation of the flame brush with deep fold inside. But this is a very special situation. If it is, if it can be realized or cannot, right now I cannot say. I think that I shall know this in a month, in a couple months.
There are no further questions, and thank Misha again. Okay, so a few more announcements. First of all,